Father, I just pray right now over these students that you would do your work, your perfect work. Lord, there's little I can say that's going to have an eternal impact. So the only thing I can say much is that Jesus loves them. And so I just pray that that would just be embedded in their heart this morning, this afternoon, for some reason, I pray. Now, I'm really excited to be with you guys. So a lot of seniors are taking AP tests, right? How many seniors do I have in here? Any seniors?
Ooh. Yeah.
Boom! What you got left? Like a week, 2 weeks? A week and 2 weeks? About 7 days left, okay. My seniors have like 3 days left. They're finishing up their exams. As a matter of fact, I'm playing hooky on one of them this afternoon so that I can speak to y'all. It broke my heart to be able to do that, but I get to do that with you guys. Where are my juniors at? Juniors? All right. Big class. I like it. But I mean, big relatively speaking. Sophomores, where you at? Sophomores, alright. Alright, so freshmen, where you at?
Yeah.
Freshmen. 8th graders.
Woo!
Yeah! Now that they're living a lot. 7th graders.
Coach Stevens, I don't know, man. I don't know how I can deal with
conscience when I've made such a poor mistake. Well, let me just tell you, you're in good company this morning, this afternoon. If I keep saying this morning on the screen in a second. This afternoon, you've got teachers that love you, that really do love you. Sometimes it may not feel like it, but I promise you they love you. If not, they wouldn't be doing this. I can guarantee you that. I can tell you for a surety that every one of your teachers and the guy speaking to you this morning, this afternoon, has made some really stupid choices. I'm not talking about just as a young person. Sometimes as an adult, we just make dumb decisions. And I've made dumb decisions as a preacher, as a pastor, as a daddy, as a husband, as a teacher, as a coach, as a referee. I make dumb decisions in every aspect of my life. I really have. And by the way, so will you. You're going to make some dumb decisions in your life. But there's some of you that you feel like you can't even handle it. And the good news is this. Jesus Christ died on the cross for your dumb decisions. For your sins. For your transgressions against the holy God. Jesus died for those. Don't let it be so familiar because you come to a Christian school because you forget that. I think sometimes familiarity breeds contempt. Meaning that if you're around it for too long, it almost becomes immune to you. You don't even really pay attention to it. Jesus died on the cross for your sins. I find it so terrible, Mr. Fulmeister, that we could have a school like this that is here to be able to point students to Christ. I feel terrible because I know that there are some of you that are not going to choose Jesus. It's a choice. Nobody's going to make you do this. Your teachers can, your parents can, your grandparents can, and I certainly can. Nobody's going to make you do this. You have to make that choice all by yourself. It is a choice. This is the day that the Lord has made. So the first thing that we see is a creator. God is the one that created you, and he created you with purpose. He created you with passion. He created you so that you have a skill set and a gifting that only you have. I didn't know, like, my seniors, I didn't know what I was going to do when I grew up. Like, if I was sitting there right there where you're at, to be honest with you, at this time, I was freaking out. Because, like, half the people knew what they were going to be doing in life. By the way, they don't. They just seem like they do. There's probably, like, two people out of all the people that know what they're going to be doing. They're going to change their major four times. That's the average now. That majors get changed four times in college. And it just seems like they've got it all together. But I thought everybody had it together except for me, so I was scared. I didn't know what I was going to do. I looked at every option, military. I had a military recruiter there. Man, we're about ready to sign the paper. My dad says, "Duh, man, if you sign that paper, that's going to be 4 years of your life." And all of a sudden, boom, that started rattling in my brain back and forth. 4 years of your life, 4 years of your life, 4 years of your life. I can't do this. Boom, I give him the paper back. He said, "I'm sorry. I wish you would reconsider." I did. I knew that's not what I was supposed to do. I didn't know what I was supposed to do, but I just knew that that wasn't what I was supposed to do. Then I started to go to college, and my major was general ed. You know, general. I don't know. General. I don't know what I'm going to do. God called me to ministry. I don't even know what that means. I just know that God wanted to use me, and I was available, and so I said, "Yes, whatever you want me to do, God, I will do." Preacher was preaching. He said, "Man, just sign the check for your life and put your name on it and give it to God and say, here it is. I'll do whatever." And I did. God, whatever you want me to do. I like sports. I really do. I love sports. And I didn't know how sports could play in an involvement in my life. What I found is this. It's played a huge role in my life. In ministry, in coaching, and teaching. In just about every aspect of my life, it's played a huge role. But the choice was made back there to follow Jesus. And then the rest of it just fell into place. So today, this morning, this afternoon, it is a choice for you. You're going to have to make that choice. Because there's a creator that created you with a passion and skills and giftings. It's going to be different. Man, there's going to be people that are going to sit around you that they're good with computers. stink with computers. I'm just not very good at all. There's going to be some that are good with their hands like mechanics. Like they're going to get in there and start working on stuff. And they're going to be really good at it. Good, because we need people like that as well. There's going to be people that are going to be like doctors and lawyers. And sometimes you're going to feel like you don't measure up. Whatever God has created you to do, that's like the highest calling you could get. Whatever He's created you to do is the highest calling that you can get. It's probably not going to be president of the United States. I mean, say, you know, you can be anything that you want to be, but really you can't. You need to be what it is that God's created. There's only been, what, 45, 46 presidents in the history of our country, so not everybody's going to be the president. So you've got to figure out what it is that God's created you to do. So there's a creator. That's what we see first of all in this. This is the day the Lord has made. You didn't make this day. The fact of the matter is a lot of you are going to take most of your life trying to be God, and you're not going to do a very good job. You say, what do you mean, Coach Stevens? You're going to try to be the king of your life. You're going to make the decisions without consulting God. My seniors, you got to make some heavy decisions, college or not college, you know, where to go, where to live. I mean, the next 4 years are going to be heavy in your life. And so Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not unto your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your paths. Now, if you don't ask God, He's not going to answer that prayer. So you have to ask Him, God, what do you want for my life? So I did. That's what I asked Him. He just gave me the next step. He still didn't give me like the whole plan. I have no idea. Whatever it is that God wants me to do, that's what I'm going to do. And I just keep stepping out. He illuminates one step, and I just take that one step. Because He's the creator, I'm not. I don't know the rest of my life. I don't have some great master plan. Because He's creator, and I'm not. Look, you're not going to do a good job of being God for you. You're not. Look, probably whatever y'all got talking about is probably really important. But you might want to pay attention, because it's probably something that I'm going to say that you might want to know. All right, I've let you talk for about 10 minutes now. Now it's time to stop. Okay? So, there's a creator. Then we see that this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice. That's a choice. One of the first times of being a youth pastor, I went there and I took my teenagers, and this guy named Ron Riley was speaking. Ron Riley was this huge speaker, like spoke to tens of thousands of students at one time. So I'll never forget this illustration Ron Riley gave about the big ball. Anybody ever play, like you went to a camp or whatever, and they had that like huge ball, it's like a big volleyball, but it was like bigger than like 10 people? And you know what I'm talking about? If you raise your hand if you know what I'm talking about, that huge ball. All right, so like five of you. Okay, cool. You'll really get this illustration then. All right, so it's like this huge ball. It's like kind of soft and kind of like a volleyball, maybe more a little softer than that, but it's huge. So it takes like five people to throw the ball. Well, he gave this illustration about the big ball. Well, there was this person in his youth group that they chose not to have fun. You ever been around a person that just chooses not to have fun? They always complain. Like, no matter what, like, then you can have the best speaker in the world up here. Hey. Just kidding. You can have the best speaker, and they're not going to get anything out of it because they don't know. They just don't care. You can have the best meal in the cafeteria. Like, they're going to complain about something about it. Like, it seems like they complain about everything, and that's their choice. They complain about everything. And Ron Riley said, we would play that big ball, and there would inevitably always be that one kid in the youth group that wasn't going to have fun. Everybody else is having fun. I mean, if you've ever played with this thing, you know it's a blast. I mean, you've never been owned by anything until that huge ball just knocks you over. It's incredible. People would just be falling down like flies. It's awesome. You take this, you know, seven football guys, throw it over, and they hit the two volleyball girls, and they just get knocked out, and it's fine. We're kind of got it. So it was just fun. And then like 10 volleyball girls would get together. No, you're not going to do it to us. And they'd pick on the one little JV football player, and they'd knock him out. And it was just great. It was fun, lots of fun.
that one person, that one person that just wouldn't have fun. And what Ron said was, that was your choice. You made a choice not to have fun. And I wonder how many times we've had the big ball. And also a Christian, the proverbial one, and you had something that was designed that was for greatness, and you just missed the boat because you made a choice not to get it. You just made a choice. It's your choice. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice. That is your choice. Nobody can make you rejoice. Nobody. You say, Coach Stevens, if you knew my life, you would know why I couldn't rejoice. Oh, okay. You're different from every person that's ever lived in the world. Like, nobody else has anything bad happen in their lives. I'm dealing with a clientele right now at my school. On the daily, I've got somebody that I'm counseling with. On the daily. I've got some people with some pretty thick stuff. Just a day ago, one of my girl soccer players comes up to me. And she doesn't know much English. She's from El Salvador. And she came to the United States, and she lives with an uncle and an aunt. And she said that they had not spoken to her in 2 months. I called her name. I said, what happened? Did you do something? I mean, did you disrespect them? Or, because you know, I know how it is in the community. And, no, sir. Disrespect them at all. They just won't talk to me. She made this statement. I just feel like I want to disappear. That's the kind of stuff I get. I always point them back to Jesus. He has a public school, but I just point them to Jesus. 3 days before that, another one of my girls' soccer players called us late one night, and her mom and stepdad had gotten into it, and they got in a fight, and my player stepped in the middle of it, and the stepdad punched her right in the nose, broke her nose. She said, Coach, I don't know what to do. I got some great big speech for him, but I can't tell you this. Point it back to Jesus. Say, what good's that gonna do? The creator that created them knows exactly why that junk happens. I can't tell them why. I don't know why. I don't know why stuff like that happens. I'm not smart enough to know. But I do know this. Every person in here has some bad stuff that happens to them. I can unpack some bad stuff that's happened to me. Don't really have time and effort to be able to do that right now. But I can tell you I've had some really bad things happen. The fact of the matter is, it's your choice whether you're going to rejoice or not. And it's a daily choice. It's daily. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice. It's my choice. It's your choice. So I just want to ask a question here. Do you really choose that, like, in your day? Like, have you chosen that? I'm a teacher, so I'm an English teacher. Have you chosen English teachers? Is that good? Have you chosen? Okay, we'll go with that. That's good? Okay, good. English teacher, maybe the check. Let's see. Have you chosen to rejoice today? Have you made that choice? Because if you don't, then who gets to do it for you? You don't have an out because of your circumstances. You don't have an out because it's not good enough in your life to rejoice. You don't have an out because you go to Aucilla Christian. You don't have an out because of your surrounding community. You have no outs. Because every person in here has a choice. My best friend, his name is Craig Polson. And just real quick, I'm going to tell you about Craig. Craig got saved when he was about 17 years old. He became a follower of Jesus Christ. He turned from his sins and turned to Jesus. I didn't know how to tell him. I felt bad because I became a follower of Christ when I was 8 years old. I just didn't know how to tell him. So I pointed him to the guy that I knew good, which was my brother, who was a little bit older than me. So Craig ends up getting saved. He ends up going to the church that he was going to. And they did not teach salvation by grace through faith. And he went there and he talked to the spiritual leader. The spiritual leader didn't know how to get saved. Craig showed him verses. He didn't even know how to get saved himself, the guy. So like it became a moot point. Craig had three stepdads. All in a row. Last one, beat them. Beat the mom. Beat the kids. It was rough. He grew up in a rough situation. But when he got saved, his life was radically changed. He became a follower of Jesus, and he said, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to break that cycle. It's not going to happen in my life. And so he made a choice. And no, it's not easy, and it doesn't happen overnight. And once you get saved, it's just not like a rose petal garden where you just kind of like just tiptoe through the tulips and everything's going to be okay. No, that's not true. If you're a Christian, you've been for any length of time, you know that's not true. God doesn't just pave the way for you that's like nice and easy. Sometimes he makes it harder for you. Because to whom much is given, much is what? Required. It's required of you. God's given some of you so much talent. And he's going to be asking for a lot in return. I refused to look at that in my own life when I was a senior. Man, I'm just not good enough. I did the well as being card. I had no self-confidence. At least not in spiritual things. I made some decisions that were poor choices. That could have taken me down a really, really bad road. God allowed me to turn and repent from those decisions, and I did. And some of you are right there today, and I just got to say, it's your choice, boss. Nobody else is going to make that choice for you. Nobody. I probably spoke with some of your parents. I just spoke at this huge men's retreat with over 100-some guys there, and I know probably 60-some churches were represented. I know there was some from Exit 217 because they kept saying that as part of their slogan. So I don't know, it might have been some of your parents, I don't know. And in talking to those adults, I realized that it's no different than talking to teenagers. We got the same problems in the world. I'm like 18 years old with 30 years of experience. Like really, I feel like I'm 18 years old. Only I'm not. I can remember when I was 18 years old, like it was yesterday. Only I'm not 18 years old anymore. Your life's but a vapor, the Bible says in James, and it's going to appear and then it's going to vanish. I can't tell you how many funerals I've preached and people that were unsuspecting that had no idea. I'm glad that you said that there was no deaths or anything that I knew needed to know about, like in the student body. But to be honest with you, we have. It's a struggle for us. Every year, we have deaths in our school. Most of the time, it's by car accidents. But our student body is almost getting used to it in a bad way. Your life is a vapor. It's here, and it vanishes away. So I know we're about out of time, but it's a choice, and you have a creator. But I want to close out with this. Most of you, most of us, have what we know as, it's known as critic's math. So there was this TV sitcom series, and it was the most popular one ever. It was called Seinfeld. And I'm not debating whether you should watch it or not. I'll let your Bible teachers talk to you about that. However, it was one of my favorite ones. And it was just funny. They would just take random stuff. And this guy that did it was a genius. His name was Larry David, and he was this genius. And so Seinfeld had been on for years, and it was the most popular show, and then it stopped. And now reruns are still being shown decades after. And so Larry David goes into Yankee Stadium. And I'm going to teach you about critics' math, because all of you are like this. So Larry David goes in there, he's sitting down, and they're panning the audience, and they see him, and they stop on him. And everybody recognizes him, and they start playing the Seinfeld theme song. And it's going across, and everybody stands up. There were over 50,000 people at Yankee Stadium, and they all stand up and clap for him. Pretty cool night, isn't it? 50,000 people stand on their feet and clap for you. He goes out of the stadium. He's walking to his car. This dude drives by, puts the window down in his car, and in typical New York fashion, the guy says, "Hey, Larry, you're still a bum." A little bit later, Larry goes out, and he's talking to a reporter, and they said, that must have been really cool that 50,000 people stood on their feet. But do you know what happens in critics' math? Here's critics' math. I'm going to teach you guys something today. Critics' math is this. One criticism plus 1,000 compliments equals what? Anybody know? Anybody want to take a guess? One criticism plus 1,000 compliments equals one criticism. 50,000 people standing on their feet, they're like screaming for the guy. They're like, "Yeah, you're awesome, dude." This one dude calls him a bum. And that's all he can think about the rest of the night. My friends, you're making a choice. It's all about perspective. You can focus on the 50,000 people that are cheering for you, or you can focus on that one dude that's not. It's your choice, though. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad. Listen, I can only do a little bit in a little bit of time. But I hope today that you are encouraged. I hope today that you will drive that verse down in your heart, that you will memorize it. This is the day that the Lord has made. And then personalize it. I will rejoice and be glad. It's your choice. It's your choice. Let's close in prayer. Lord, I know right here today there's people that aren't making that choice. And to be honest with you, they're not rejoicing, and really, this message made them a little bit mad. And I totally understand that. I've been there. But today, Lord, I pray that they would make a conscious decision to let you be Lord of their lives. And because as the psalmist said, that we should choose to rejoice in you, that they would make that same exact choice. I pray that that would be as relevant today as it was almost 3,000 years ago when it was written. Help us to make that choice. Thank you for such an awesome student, by the Lord. I pray from all the way from the people that are about ready to graduate and walk across that stage and hop into real world stuff and make some big boy and big girl decisions, Lord. I pray that you give wisdom. Wisdom that comes from you. James 1:5 says that if we lack wisdom, we're to ask of you, and that you give to all people freely. And so I pray that you do that. Give them wisdom, Lord. I pray all the way down through all, even to our sixth graders, Lord. Some of them may not even been able to pick up too much out of this, but I pray that they will remember that you are Lord, and that we can choose you. God, if there's anybody here that doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, I pray that they will get with their teacher, with their administrator. They'd hit me up on Facebook or somebody that loves them and cares for them, their parents, and just tell them that they have struggled in their relationship and that they want to talk to them about you. God, give us that. We ask that in the name of Jesus.